about to join Don Neuen, co-host of Cowboy Logic Radio, and Denise Simon, host of the Denise Simon Experience, for a weekly situation report, or SITREP. 18 hours a day, Denise Simon lives her life as an Intel analyst. 18 hours a day, Don Neuen lives his life in the world of rock and roll. 1 hour each day, Neuen receives a daily SITREP from Simon. Welcome to the Drive Time Situation Report. Fasten your seatbelt. You're now in Don Neuen's car, and he is calling in for his SITREP.
Hello.
What's happening, Denise Simon? It's your buddy Don calling in for tonight's sit rep. How you doing?
Alrighty then. Just Ducky, how are you?
I'm doing good, but I got a special treat for you.
Oh.
I got a special treat for you, niece. I got a buddy of mine. His name is Derek Robinson. He and I go back to like Little League days for my kids. We've known each other for probably 15 years. I met him the first time. When he was Parker's Little League coach. And there's two things I want to say about my buddy Derek Robinson. First of all, he's a stand-up American, and I got a lot of respect for him.
Secondly, then I do too.
And secondly, he knows how to handle children, and I respect him even more for that. Okay? He was a great, great baseball coach.
Hello, Derek. Like you.
Derek,
how y'all doing
here with us, buddy? Yeah, there you are, man. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome you to the Drive Time Situation Report, also known as the Drive Time Sit Rep. My name is Don Neuen.
Oh.
And I'm driving home from work after a grueling day in the world of rock and roll. I'm driving through the hood right now, so if I have any crack whores that come up to me, oh my God, I'm at a stoplight. I don't know what to do right now. Denise, I'm vulnerable. I feel scared. I'm lying.
See if you happen to see my son's stolen truck and my son's stolen motorcycle. He's had two claims in 2 months.
I'm looking for it. He needs to move out into the country.
He is. He's moving today to Sandy Springs.
That's why you have to travel with crack rocks so that you can have something to distract them with.
Yeah, he walked out on his lease today. I told him to.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, this radio show is unlike any other, as I'm sure you're able to figure out in the first 5 minutes of it, okay? Here's what we're doing, guys and gals. You're riding home with me from work. I'm calling into Denise Simon, which is what I do every night, sometimes every morning, to get a situation report. Because unlike Denise Simon, I don't have time to spend 18 hours a day in the world of intelligence analyzing. Okay, I'm dealing with rock stars that don't put their pants on one leg at a time. So at any rate, I call into Denise. Now, the reason that I call into Denise is so that I appear more intelligent than I normally would. And the reason that I appear more intelligent and have all of you fooled is because she is so far ahead of the curve that she briefs me on all of the necessities that took place throughout the day.
Overselling.
So welcome to the Drive Time Situation Report. I want to thank our affiliates right off the top of the bat, Talk America Radio and talkamericaradio.us. That's our digital flagship network. We've also got to thank WDDQ, Talk 92.1 FM out of South Georgia, WJHC, 107.5 FM out of North Florida, and our most recent affiliate as of right around the beginning of the year, I think, so it's not really that recent anymore, WLBB, 1330 AM and 106.3 FM out of West Georgia. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We promise you that we will not waste any more of your time. Denise, let's get after it. Let's do a time stamp so that we can date this show.
9:37 p.m. Eastern, August the 16th, 2017.
All right, now, ladies and gentlemen, this is different than we usually come to you with this drive time sit rep, because we've got a buddy of mine in here, Derek Robinson.
Derek
and I don't always see eye to eye politically. I think that's a safe assessment. But what we do see eye to eye on is that we are each Americans before we are Republicans or conservatives or Democrats or liberals or centrists or black or white. We are Americans first.
Say that one more time.
We are Americans first.
There we go.
Before anything else. That doesn't mean that we put being an American before being a parent or being a follower of God. But what it does mean is that we are not anything but Americans with different ideas at times, some of which are very similar, though, quite frankly, Derek. So at any rate, Denise, let's get into this, and I want to give fair time here to Derek. So, Derek, the way this operates is there is no script. We just fly by the seat of our pants, and we get after it, and we're going to get after it right now. Denise, what the hell is going on?
Well, first, I'm going to kind of throw a curveball into all of this, because I do want to do a somewhat of a public service announcement for people out there that have children of teenage years or maybe even a little bit older, because there is a phenomenon going on in the United States and in Europe. And millennials going down into the teenage years are being lured by Facebook with some very curious postings that they're clicking on, and they are being recruited to being mules, and not the where they're going to carry drugs or narcotics or any other illicit material, but they are being asked to set up bank accounts and in their own names, which they do. And then these cartels or these gangs or whatnot are giving them money to deposit into the accounts. The teenager gets to keep 10%. And the other 90 goes to back to the person, because that person has probably been given an ATM card. So what is happening here is that's how they're doing the money laundering. And it is, they're also, if they're not being necessarily recruited through Facebook, it is happening on a middle school, high school, and college campuses. In some cases too, Don and Derek, parents are putting their kids up to this because it's an additional income for the whole family. So this is happening in Corpus Christi, Texas. This is happening in Arizona. This is happening in Britain. This is happening in California. So I would say, if all of a sudden it appears that your child is spending a little extra time on Facebook, you might have to be a helicopter parent and go see what they're doing and who they're talking to. And or if they end up with a little extra cash that you don't know where it came from, it might be that they have some unknown bank account that they're sharing with some gangs or some cartel members, and they're helping them clean money. So there is a little bit of a public service announcement.
This is not a scam like some of these things are. You know, my name's so-and-so from Nigeria, and I've got $10 million that I need for you to help me spend. This is actual profiting that can be going on, but what's happening is these kids are being duped into being money laundering mules.
Yeah, and they may not know that. They're just saying, hey, man, we got this little gig for you, and these gangs are, you know, not telling them the whole truth. It just says, I'm going to give you $1,000. You get to keep 50. And the kid's going to go, cool, I haven't had $50 in 2 years. You know what I mean?
Derek, how old are your kids?
Oh, I got them all over the spectrum. My oldest is just going off to college his first week. He's 18. I got my middle son. He's 15. And then I got my youngest boy, who's 6. So,
well, I'd say with the exception of the 6-year-old. Yeah, I'd say with the exception of the 6-year-old, the other two, you need to let them know about this. Denise, is this kind of a thing carrying any kind of a criminal charge if these people are caught?
Yeah, the kids end up in juvenile, and they're not necessarily cutting them a break. So, I mean, and the kid could have more than one bank account. They could have five or six, you know, one for themselves and the other, you know, that these gangs are managing.
And I would assume that this is not like any kind of a form letter email crap that people fall for that, you know, have an IQ of 9.
No.
This is more where these people are going into social media. They're befriending these kids.
Yeah, and say, hey, meet me over at the 7-Eleven right off the high school campus and let's talk. I'll give you a fast $50.
So there is real literal FaceTime and relationships are being built.
Yes.
Wow.
Scary,
that's
isn't
not,
it?
Yeah, that's not cool.
And so when that's you're kind of cool driving through the hood here, you know, I'm thinking to myself, well, hey, you know, so people need to go see what's happening, you know, on these school campuses right after school, even before school or at lunchtime. And if your kid ends up with, some money in their wallet or in their pocket that they really shouldn't have or they can't completely justify having, I'd start asking some harder questions.
You got to kind of keep an eye on everything, you know.
You do. Derek.
I just had to talk with about opioids with my oldest son. You know, I was just telling him to watch out. You know, these pills are a lot more discreet than the things that my generation was doing. So it's like, you know, you never know, and it seems cool, but you got to kind of watch yourself. And I'm glad you mentioned that. That just gave me something else to warn him about. This world is going crazy.
It is nuts. It is. It's absolutely nuts. So I'd be watching for that one. Any of the listeners out there, if you got kids in that age range, raise an eyebrow and have a chat with them. Very important. But onward and upward.
Yeah, man, that's creeping me out, Denise.
Well, I know there's another story I have about eBay too, but I mean that that is where we have got some nasty people here in the United States that create these eBay accounts. They're putting up items that might be a value of, I don't know, $800, $1,000, $2,000, whatever it is, you know, a TV or, you know, a piece of jewelry or something. And they've got connections outside the United States. So people outside the United States create an account that appears to be inside the United States. And the people outside the United States do a buy now kind of thing. And the money transfers, but nothing is ever shipped, because it's a fake product. So what happens? You've got money laundering that's going on that way, or you have got terrorists and jihadists that are moving money from outside the United States inside the United States, where they are funding some things that they shouldn't be funding. So they're also using an eBay platform.
I don't know about you guys, but I just get up and go to work and break my ass every day to earn a living, pay my taxes, and put roofs, you know, a roof over my house and food on my table. I don't have time to sit around and try to figure out ways to con millennials into money laundering. Nor, I mean, these people, this is sick.
It's the world I kind of live in. You don't want to follow me around every day.
I just came across something that was odd and weird. They were taking their social security number and the name and attaching a Federal Reserve Bank routing number and paying for items online.
Yeah. And you wonder how busy our FBI really is, because they're busy. They have to track all these little things down.
Unbelievable. All right, Denise, let's get it. Hey, first of all, everybody, welcome to the Drive Time SITREP. This is a little bit different tonight. We've got a buddy of mine who's now a buddy of Denise's. Derek Robinson is joining us. So we've got kind of a three-way thing going on here. So, Denise, there is so much you-know-what hitting the fan right now within the Trump administration. People are asking me, hey, what do you think about what's going on? And I'm going, you know what? I'm not even going to touch this right now until the water settles and we can figure out what the heck is going on. Whether we got, you know, some guy that that supports racist hate groups, or whether or not we don't. What are you figuring out with everything over the past couple of days? Because this is just almost putting me on overload.
Well, it is, and it's a topic that it's festering, and there are so many piece parts to it that I have kind of chosen to kind of sit back and watch what really shakes out here. I'm kind of tired of listening to the TV telling me what I should be thinking. I'm just not going to do that. I'm gonna look for real evidence here and then make some kind of conclusion. But what has happened is, as a result of what media is telling us of what happened in Charlottesville, and as a result of what Trump said, didn't say, when he said it, and whatever, a pretty bad thing happened this morning, and the timing, I would say, couldn't be any worse. Early this morning, the 8th CEO resigned from Trump's council. He had two councils. One is a strategy and policy council, which has to do with manufacturing. And then the other one was kind of a jobs initiatives council. So we had a handful of these CEOs in the last, I don't know, a week or so that had resigned. The eighth one, there's 17 members originally. The eighth one resigned this morning. Directly after that, the ones that remained got on a conference call, and they all came to a accommodation that they were all bailing out and leaving the council. So I guess somebody took the lead and called the White House and said, this council, you don't have anybody anymore. And so Trump comes out with a tweet that says, rather than putting pressure on the business people of the Manufacturing Council and Strategy and Policy Forum, I am ending both. Thank you all, with 3 exclamation points. And that was it. Now, there are people on there from, 3M to Under Armour to General Motors or, whatever else. But the other thing that happened today is the beginning discussions of the NAFTA were launched. And as a consequence, it could be that with Trump taking a hard line on renegotiating NAFTA, where these corporations and many other corporations in the United States were, years and years and years of NAFTA, that may have set them off as well. We don't know. But the timing couldn't be any worse, because right after the August break, leading into right after Labor Day, is when we're supposed to also come out with the tax reform plan. Now, of course, corporations are the highest taxed and the highest tax bracket of the industrial world. And now we don't know where this would necessarily go. So this thing kind of is a bad gig for this White House. I've had a couple people tell me, well, these two councils that he had weren't really doing anything anyway. I kind of disagree with that, because it was a point in time where these corporations would tell policy people in this White House and in some of the agencies that regulations are hurting us from growing. They'd be talking about minimum wages. They would be talking about growth and expansion and all these other kinds of things. So it was, I think it was very good for discussions. But now that's over with. So, a couple days ago, when he was at 3 or 4 that had left, Trump came out and said, well, that's okay. I've got plenty more that are standing in line to come on the council. And then the eighth one resigned today. It's okay. Well, where are these other guys? So I think he got a little petulant and just kind of shut the whole thing down. It was Merck, it was Intel, it was Campbell Soup, it was 3M. These are some pretty big players. Now, some of them are saying, well, they're all liberals and, they couldn't take it and they bailed out. So you see what I'm saying? There's all kinds of moving parts on what these real reasons are. But I think the one that suffers the most is the employees of these companies, and I would say any potential new hires, because they're kind of just left out there to fend for themselves. What say you, guys?
Well,
sounds like he's going to take the ball and go home. You know, it's one of those, another one of those things where he doesn't realize that he's the president of the United States, and we need someone to be presidential and a leader. And you just don't say, "Hey, you're not leaving. I fired you." That's what it sounds like to me. Like, grow up, man. Something needs to go down. Something needs to happen.
Yeah, there's absolutely no room in the role of a president to be knee-jerk. And I think that many times Trump ends up reacting instead of acting. And that's a huge flaw. Derek, let me throw a question at you, and I'd like to get your perspective from, if at all possible, through the eyes of the black community, in which what is the discussion, what is the dialogue that's taking place, the temperament right now after the enormous onslaught, and I'm going to kind of slant this question a little bit, the enormous onslaught of the mainstream media that is most definitely beating the drum that Donald Trump is not willing to, slam the white racist KKK and alt-right. You know, they're just playing this thing up to the hilt. What is the reaction and the temperament in the black community, in a black church, or in a, I don't even know if you go to a black church. I'm kind of searching here because I want to get the feel of the black community.
So, well, first of all, let me, caveat everything by saying, I'm just one guy. I'll give you, the opinions of people who I communicate with, and that's all I can say. As far as the, generalized black people in black America, I'm not going to take responsibility to speak for everyone. Now, that being said, nothing that I've heard has been positive. Nothing that I've heard has been supportive. There have been several main things that's come out of this. One is, we told you so. What did you think was going to happen with this guy? His character and morality has been the same since the beginning. And you guys, the majority, the Americans and everybody, you chose him. Now you got to live with it now. And there's a lot of embarrassment. People are laughing and are also embarrassed because they can't have their kids look up to anybody anymore. As far as the main leader, this is our country, and the people want somebody to point to. They also are saying this is a calling card. This is time to rally up and do something and say something and cast a vote. Some of the more responsible people have taken that attitude. Most of all, there's been a lot of anger about the. Just the morality of it. He comes on to the interview and says, "Hey, I just wanted to take time to get all the facts." Well, when the CEO of Merck resigned, and he happens to be African American, and let's just say American first, because I really want to drop all the labels. But when he resigned from the council, it took him less than an hour to blast this guy on social media. But you can't blast a Nazi walking around with swastikas. We don't understand. And then for him to, it seems to the capitulation and the attachment of his name to some of these crazy people, not crazy, but just insane type of people that represent the small minority of white race. I don't see any swastikas around, where I go. But at the same time, how can you even want to have David Duke come out and tell you that I'm fulfilling your wishes? You have to distance yourself from that. That's just basic. It's just basic humanity, basic morality. This guy's not showing it, and people are upset.
Well, no doubt they are. I want to make a comment on David Duke. First of all, I think David Duke is an idiot. He has no credibility with me. He donated money to Hillary Clinton. He may have donated money to Donald Trump. David Duke has no credibility with me. Denise, I do have a hard time, though, with why, and this may be just a floundering communication department in the White House failing miserably with a knee-jerk reaction president, but why would Trump, in the first statement, you know, condemn the KKK, white racism, you know, these alt-right racists? I mean, as a strong conservative, as a strong constitutional conservative, I do not possess a prejudiced or racist bone in my body, unless racism is defined as being something that would be able to differentiate between race simply by the color of the skin and acknowledging that. And Neil Bortz at one time made that definition of racism, basically saying everyone is a racist because you can't help but differentiate between someone of color and someone that might be considered white. But Derek knows me. I don't have a racist bone in my body. I wasn't raised that way, and I didn't raise my children that way, and I refuse to live my life that way. And I refuse to associate with anybody that does. Why didn't Trump come out of the gate saying something like that?
I can't speak for him. I can't do it. When it comes to this topic, I don't think that you need to have advisors in your White House that tell you what you need to say and what you don't need to say. You speak from the heart. And this is not a new topic. This has been going on for a very long time. And it's been festering for a very long time. Trump didn't get it right. I mean, I would have said Saturday, I would have called up the media and said, get the cameras over here. I got something I want to say. And I think he would have said, who are you people that are doing this? I mean, what are you? And you walk among us and have you no shame, all of you. And, you know, just said, I'm in a complete other state of disgust. This is not where we should be. We've come a long way and now we're going backwards. I mean, there was a lot of things all those things you could have said from the heart. I mean, I watch this stuff night after night after night. I'm not listening to it because I have my TV on mute because I can't stand it any longer. But I mean, you speak from the heart and that would be easy to do. So I don't think you need advisors. I mean, no, somebody might say, well, put it this way. If you're going to say something, put it this way. I mean, they might refine a word or two. But for the most part, it should be so simple. And
yeah, this is like the biggest no-brainer in the history of the world. Derek, let me throw a question at you. You know, the mainstream media, which I have disdain for, has jumped all over this, sometimes devoting 100% of their airtime to this, when we've got so many, quite frankly, big problems that we need to be dealing with, like Iran, like North Korea, like Russia, like China.
Tax reform, jobs. Yeah.
And that's all. Yeah, that's not even going into the domestic issues that we need to be dealing with. But the mainstream media chooses on this situation, which again, I would like to smack Trump in the face for not taking care of business the way his heart should have been telling him to do it. Because again, it's a no-brainer. But if you remember back to when the left set fire and destroyed the Berkeley campus, why do you feel that the mainstream media is not handling this situation in Charlottesville the same way that they handled the situation in Berkeley, where they destroyed public property, where they destroyed the ability of freedom of speech? Where, you know, what's your thoughts on the double standard with the mainstream media and how they're obsessed with this kind of a thing?
It's the same. It's the history of the media, and I ask you, who owns the media? Who's giving us this information? Why? What is the agenda of the people who own these news outlets, right? So when it suits them, they show up, right? When you carry around swastikas, that offends the people who own these media outlets. So you have to go back and look and see who it is that's putting out this information and where it's coming from. And of course, always follow the money. So, you know, that's how I feel about it. The reason that this story is getting so much press and everything like that is because it's the anti-Semitic view. And that's something that certain people that own media companies, that's one thing that they won't sit down for. So, to be honest with you, that's how I feel about that. I mean, you know, you talk about other things and what other situations happen, and they don't get any press at all, or everything is a status quo. You know, move on. Oh, he's a brown guy. You know, he deserved that. That's why, or he didn't do this, or he didn't comply with this policeman or that thing, or you know, any of those situations that's been happening and being videotaped by regular people nowadays. Those stories weren't getting covered until the outrage from social media came about. And so now I just harken back to the fact that the mainstream media, who controls it, what's their agenda, and where is the money? And that's why you won't get that kind of coverage for the same act of certain people and certain groups.
All right. I'm going to ask you to speculate on something, and this is something that Denise Simon will never, ever do. But I'd like to throw this out to both of you. What if 2 weeks from now we were able to learn that the funding for the hate that took place in Charlottesville came from left-wing organizations? What would your thought be if you found out that the funding that took place in Charlottesville came from someone like a George Soros?
Wow. I mean, that would be a blow. I mean, you know, you think that the people that you stand behind, or that the people that you support, or even the people that you think have your best interest at heart, wouldn't do certain things, but inevitably it's proven that they are just as corrupt as the other people. And it's, to me, you know, it's so crazy, because you don't think that they would, but they do. I don't think this is a conservative versus a liberal. I think this has to do with power and money. And so it doesn't matter. Democrat, Republican, they all have dirt. They all do these types of things in a struggle to keep their own power and to keep their own agenda and to keep other people away from the things that they hold dear.
Well, I'm going to take you back here just a little bit, and I'm going to give you some of the names that have contributed to Antifa, because it's actually on their websites.
Before you do that, explain who Antifa is to everyone, please.
Well, that's the anti-fascist movement that we have been experiencing for a while. And Antifa actually was born in Europe, and the movement has come to our shores. So it is short for anti-fascist, and I would argue that it is somewhat of a hypocrisy in motion here, because they are also very much the ones that won't allow a lot of the speakers to have free speech on college campuses, which is the reason we saw so much of the nonsense going on in UC Berkeley, for instance. But let me give you a few names here. We've got the Michigan Federation of Teachers. We've got an organization called the Inner City Miracle. We've got the Law Students for Affirmative Action. And this one's a good one. The Center for Constitutional Rights. Now, I was a student. The Center for Constitutional Rights came to my attention about 8 years ago, 7 years ago, because those are a pile of lawyers that have been the lawyer. Many of them are the lawyers of record defending the terrorist Gitmo detainees. We have the Citizens for Affirmative Actions Preservation. We have the AFL-CIO of San Francisco. We have the UAW. We have the Michigan AFL-CIO. We have the UAW Local 6000. We have the Longshoremen's Association, the Movement for Justice, SEIU Local 79, Bowling Green State University. We have SEIU Local 790. We have the Steel Case Incorporated, Women Law Students Association. There's more, but that's just a list of some of them. And you notice George Soros wasn't in that list. That doesn't mean that he hasn't, but I'm just telling you, these are some other names.
Well, I wonder how many of those organizations that you just named receive funding from a Soros entity.
Or they get, interestingly enough, government grants.
Yeah.
Because right, every single agency we have has a grant program.
All right, for the listeners, as well as for Derek and I, when you were watching the chaos that was taking place in Charlottesville this weekend, and for that matter, in other cities, including where Derek and I live in Atlanta, how would you identify some of these Antifa individuals? Because clearly you saw them, correct?
Who are you talking to, me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I saw local Virginia militia. I saw out-of-state militia. I saw KKK. I saw workersworld.org, which is a part of the Communist Party USA. I saw factions from all over the place. Now, there's one particular fellow that was there. Now, this guy kind of disturbs me beyond words. And his name is Michael Tubbs. Well, Michael Tubbs is part of an organization called the League of the South. Well, the League of the South is, it's got a direct connection to the KKK. But this Michael Tubbs fella also served prison time. He was also a Iraq veteran. But at one point,
that's the guy who was pointing to direct the fighting.
Yes, he was directing them, and he spent jail time because he actually had plotted to bomb a Jewish business and a black-owned business in Jacksonville, Florida, and he had gone to Fort Bragg and stole a bunch of weapons from there. He's a real winner here. He was been part of the racist movement since 1987. And, you know, how much jail time he served, I don't know. The Southern Poverty Law Center has listed him on their, you know, hate watch list, which is fine with me. He belongs there. So the point is that you've got the KKK, you've got Unite the Right, you've got the Antifa, you got all of this. But so there was a coordinated effort. And I think that this was, I would say, a bigger problem is all of these factions show up. And where was law enforcement? The governor called the state of emergency the day before. The mayor, called out law enforcement. People were showing up with long guns. People were showing up in their own personal riot gear. The police were in riot gear, and we still had this nonsense to go on. That's the shame of it all.
Why were they told? Why were they told to stand down? Why did the mayor or the governor tell the police department to stand? I'm assuming it would be the mayor that would do that. Told them to stand down.
I can't answer that. He says he didn't. So in there we're already in an argument there, because other people on the police.
He actually came on to a radio show that I listen to every now and then, and explain the fact that he was trying to contain a situation that could have been very much more explosive with all of the weaponry that these guys had. So he was proud of the fact that there wasn't a shot fired because of all the rifles. And he admitted that it was surprising to him that this group of people were highly armed, and the armor that they were wearing were comparable to the policeman that was there. Mm-hmm. So he didn't want anybody to fire a shot. So that's why he said that he gave more instruction to be more tolerant of these people.
Yeah, but I'm going to tell you something. One of the reasons shots were not. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, he also said. I forgot to mention. He also said that they logged over 280 fights. So his excuse was that there were a myriad of fights in different places all over this city, and the police were spread thin. That's what he said.
Well, I'm going to tell you this. One of the reasons I believe that shots were not fired, because three percenters, which Denise and I were talking, that we believe there were three percenters there, and Virginia militia or any West Virginia militia, any of these militias that may have shown up, these guys are not going to fire their weapons unless their life is threatened. Most of them are well-trained. Most of them respect their weapons. There to pull triggers. They're there to prevent triggers from being pulled. And that's the viewpoint. Do you not agree with me, Denise, of people like the three percenters?
Well, there are some three percenters I have no regard for. There are others that are fine. So what, you know, you got, just like any kind of organization, you got hotheads in any of these kinds of organizations. So not all three percenters are stellar character. Which ones were which that showed up? I don't know, because I don't know any of them.
Yeah. Fair enough. Denise, have you been able, we've only got about 8 minutes here. Have you been able to track down any type of money trail? This, you know anything about this Kessler character that evidently started this? I mean, there's a lot of stuff flying around about him with regard to Occupy movement and being a big Obama supporter as recent as the fall of 2016, and now all of a sudden he appears that he's some right-wing nutcase. What do you know about Kessler?
I don't want to know. I know I've heard his name. I've heard Richard Spencer's name. I mean, they come from different corners. At this point to me, it kind of doesn't matter. What matters is that they're out there and they walk among us, and we have a problem with that. That's just where I am. I haven't looked at any money. I know that they've got a lot of these websites, you know, have donate here kind of things, or, you know, these people show up at the corporations and kind of shake them down for a donation. Otherwise, if they don't, they'll protest them, and like they did in the Occupy movement. So, I mean, you can't establish single lanes for all of this and label those with a street name and define it. It can't be done.
Derek, in closing here, right now America is in my opinion, a bit of a crisis. In my opinion, we were going through crisis moments during the Barack Obama administration. We're being fatigued. Those of us that live in this stuff every day, we're getting fatigued by the crises that are taking place both over the last 8 years and now over the last 8 months. In your opinion, what needs to happen to start turning this around and being able to heal America?
I'm going to ask that the first thing, and we spoke about this briefly before, you got to drop the labels. That's the first thing. You know, one of the main things, and then I'm talking about everything from, and I know people are going to hate me for this, but affirmative action and all those things that debilitate the people that need the help the most needs to stop. right? And the labeling, and I can't, you know, you go to apply for a loan or a job or even a website, and they want to know if I'm African American or what's my race. Like, that's not important. And besides, if you're gonna do that, then dog, what I'm gonna call you Irish American. Nobody here can tell me that they're not an immigrant somewhere down the line, but it's just assumed that, and this whole culture is built off of this premise that the majority that's here now were here in the beginning, and that this is their land. No, it didn't start like that. So the first thing I think to start healing is let's eliminate these labels and start referring to people as American and not as something hyphen American. And that can be a small beginning. Something else that needs to be acknowledged is the systematic mistreatment of certain groups of people. And I don't understand. It seems obvious to the people who I know and the people who I operate on. They sent me a text telling me not to drive through Missouri for a specific fact. They changed certain things about why you can be stopped. And they're telling you, be careful when you drive certain places. And that's ridiculous to me.
Are you talking about warnings to black folks driving through Missouri?
Yes. Yes. Okay. And it's totally ludicrous. It's ridiculous. The first thing we have to do is stop labeling and have an attitude of inclusion. We here in this country, and I'm not going to go into why we here or how we got here. I'm past all that, right? My next thing is what is going to make lives of the citizens here better, mm-hmm. all citizens, mm-hmm. and that's where I am. I'm looking for solutions, Don. I've already seen the problem. I'm intelligent enough to have researched it. I've heard it from my family and the elders of my people. You know, they've talked to me about it. It's a shame that I have to go through and talk to my son about it. It's 2017.
You're
damn right. It's a shame. Hey, Derek, let me ask you this. What do you say to the individual, Denise, you might have to help me out? He was running for president, the governor of Maryland, and I'm drawing a blank on his name, where at one point during a discussion with him, this was when he was up there on a stage with Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders.
Oh, yeah.
And I can't remember the guy's name.
Yeah.
At any rate, he didn't last long. But at one point, he made the comment, Derek, that all lives matter. And he was chastised by the left.
Martin O'Malley.
Yeah, Martin O'Malley.
Yeah. And he was chastised relentlessly, and he actually didn't have the stones to stand up to it, and he backed down. And he goes, yeah, you're right. All lives don't matter. Paraphrasing, obviously. What do you say to the people that apply pressure to him like that?
Okay, so I can't read the intent of people, right? So when they say certain things, it makes no sense to me. Like, it's almost like when you step up and say, I'm proud to be black, people get offended because, what, I'm not supposed to be proud? You know, it's like when we say, hey, man, look here, like, Black Lives Matter, it's a saying, it's a call to the people to let everyone else know something is going wrong here. You are killing these people for no reason at all, and they're getting off, and it doesn't make any sense. So when you say Black Lives Matter, we're not saying that white lives don't matter. We don't say that blue lives don't matter. What we're saying is, hey, recognize the fact that there's a systematic, there's a government in place with a systematic destruction of a certain people. And I know you guys don't like this guy, but I remember a quote from somebody that said that if you have a house and there's a kettle pot in your house and it's about to explode, A, you either need to remove the kettle pot or you need to change the conditions, meaning turn down the fire. Like, you see what's going to happen. What do you think is going to happen? And so when he said all lives matter, it was offensive because that's not what the intent of Black Lives Matter meant.
Understood.
Yeah, but here's the thing. But at the same time, if you want to unify, if you want to correct, if you want to restore, if you want to repair, I submit to everyone that cares about their fellow men and women, Denise, that you put down the signs that say Black Lives Matter, you put down the signs that say any label matters. And I'm going back to what you said there, and all lives matter. And the message could have been just as strong, in my opinion, if blacks and whites would have united against the atrocities against black individuals or Hispanic individuals, and said, damn it, all lives matter, and marched with that, sending that message that, in fact, all lives do matter. And that, to me, is something that didn't take place. I think the power would have been so much greater if you get marches and protests going on where, damn it, all lives matter. As opposed
Agreed.
To,
well,
as
look,
opposed to beating the drum that says Black Lives Matter.
I mean, we have, let's look at this at a global kind of condition. And we even had John Kerry admit it when he was still at the State Department, that we have a genocide going on. Okay. We've got Muslims in moderate, basic Muslims that don't want any part of anything in Syria that have had to flee their country. There are more Syrians outside of their country than are in it. We had a persecution of the Yazidis. Remember that one?
You got 1 minute. You got 1 minute, Denise.
Then we have the Jews. We've got Christians that have left. We've got white professors that are being run off of campuses here in the United States. So I would say that there's not to diminish the argument, but we need to expand the argument. And it is, Derek's right. It's a label, it's a condition, and all kinds of people are being affected that are not really speaking out. Or getting a chance
Amen.
To speak up.
Ladies and gentlemen, you've been listening to a special episode of the Drive Time Situation Report. My name is Don Neuen. I'm the co-host of Cowboy Logic Radio. We've got Denise Simon on the other end of this. She's the host of the Denise Simon Experience. And we've got our good buddy, my longtime friend, and Denise's new buddy, Derek Robinson, on here with us, that is sharing wonderful insight and words of wisdom that all of us should listen to. Ladies and gentlemen, all lives matter. You want to fix the problem of racism, you get people like Denise and Derek and myself and those that we choose to hang around with, those that we surround ourselves with, you lock arms, you carry signs that say all lives matter. Ladies and gentlemen, good night and God
thank
bless
you.
America.
Thank you.